Servants Church, Crickhowell. It's a great pleasure to see you all this morning. The weather may be a little bit blustery and cold outside, but it's lovely to gather together in the Lord's name together this morning. Great to see visitors to our church. We do welcome you if you've come to this church for the first time. And we do pray for all those who are here that we might know God's presence with us this morning. Our theme this morning is about the substance, the nature of Jesus. Who is Jesus? And we're going to be thinking about that in some of our readings and our songs this morning. We do welcome as well anyone who's watching this service, participating in the service, taking part of it online. It's a great pleasure for you to join us, and we're very happy to have you with us today. Let's just pray, shall we, as we come before the Lord this morning. Lord, we thank you for the invitation to come into your presence. We thank you that you always welcome us, however bad, however difficult, however negative we may feel. Lord, we thank you that you care and you love and you always are prepared to transform. So Lord, transform us from any negativities in our lives. Transform us into the positive sense of being in your presence today. We pray that we might worship you in spirit and in truth, and we might hear your voice speaking to us. And we pray that as we take communion together this morning, that you will meet with us in a very real way and send us out in the power of your Spirit. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to commence our service this morning by singing a well-known traditional hymn, "O Worship the Lord in the Beauty of Holiness." And we'll stand to sing together.
Thank you.
to our order of service sheet. And we take our seats for our psalm for the day, which is Psalm 138. The words will be up on the screen and we will go through the psalm with alternate verses. If you could read the verses in bold, I will read the other verses. Can I suggest that we take up our pew Bibles? And good, we're fine, we've got the psalm.
Well, it's on there, but you tapped it just the alternative verse, the bold not working, so just the alternative verse is on there. The bowl's not working.
Okay, so we haven't got the alternate verses, is that right?
They're on there, but the bowl is not working on the computer.
Everything is
bold. Everything's bold. Well, that's good, because we can all read. That's brilliant. Actually, that would be really good, because it's a psalm of praise, and it's really good that we all say it together, so let's do that. I will praise you, Lord, with all my heart. Before the gods, I will sing your praise. I will bow down towards your holy temple, and I will praise your name. For your unfailing love and your faithfulness, for you have so exalted your solemn decree that it surpasses your fame. When I called, you answered me. You greatly emboldened me. May all the kings of the earth praise you, Lord. When they hear what you have decreed, may they sing of the ways of the Lord, for the glory of all the Lord is great. Though the Lord is exalted, he looks kindly on the lowly. The lofty, he sees them from afar. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve my life. You stretch out your hand against the anger of my foes. With your right hand, you save me. The Lord will vindicate me. Your love, Lord, endures forever. Do not abandon the works of your hands. A psalm which reminds us of God's faithfulness. God is a good God. God is a God who loves us, who cares for us, who has made us and made us in his own image. So we're going to sing two songs which remind us of the goodness of God. God is good, and then we focus in on Jesus. Jesus is the name we honor. God is good.
We're
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace and peace be with you.
And with you, the Lord Christ.
We'll now spend a moment or two of quiet as we reflect on our lives and as we come into God's presence. Let's say the words together. Heavenly Father, we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and have failed to do what we ought to have done. We are sorry and truly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and lead us in his way to walk as children of light. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us and set us free from sin. Strengthen us in goodness and keep us in eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand together for the glory.
For the readings.
Just before we have the readings, we'll have our special prayer for the day, the collect for the day, the 12th Sunday after Trinity. Let's pray. Almighty and everlasting God, you are always more ready to hear than we to pray, and to give more than either we desire or deserve. Pour down upon us the abundance of your mercy, forgiving us those things of which our conscience is afraid, and giving us those good things which we are not worthy to ask. But through the merits and mediation of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We'll now have our readings for this morning.
The Old Testament reading is from Isaiah, chapter 51, verses 1 to 6. If you want to follow it in the Bible, it's page 738. Listen to me, you who pursue righteousness and who seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you are cut, and to the quarry from which you were hewn. Look to Abraham, your father, and to Sarah, who gave you birth. When I called him, he was the only one man. I blessed him and made him many. The Lord will surely comfort Zion and will look with compassion on all her ruins. He will make her deserts like Eden, her wastelands like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and the sound of singing. Listen to me, my people. Hear me, my nation. Instruction will go out from me. My justice will become a light to the nations. My righteousness draws near speedily. My salvation is on the way, and my arm will bring justice to the nations. The islands will look to me and wait in hope for my arm. Lift up your eyes to the heavens. Look at the earth beneath. The heavens will vanish like smoke. The earth will wear out like a garment, and its inhabitants die like flies. But my salvation will last forever. My righteousness will never fail. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And the New Testament reading is from Romans 12, 1 to 8. That's page 1139 in the Pew Bibles. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourselves more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ, we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Listen to the gospel according to Saint Matthew. This is Matthew 16, verses 13 to 20, and the page in the Bible is 983. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others say Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" Jesus asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Then he ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Good morning. Today we gather to reflect on extraordinary encounter between Jesus and his disciples at a city which we will later reflect on, unique in many ways in Jesus' time, Caesarea Philippi, as recorded in the Gospel of Matthew. This passage shed lights on a significant question Jesus posed to his disciples, ultimately to us. Who do you think I am? It looks simple. As Christians, we may be able to give profound theological answers to these questions. Some may be very inspirational, some may be vague. Who do you say that I am? Let us explain and explore in our minds and hearts underlining reasons why Jesus asked this question. And is this question still relevant to us in 21st century? The significance of the location where Jesus asked this question. Why Jesus did not ask this question in Jerusalem? Why not in Nazareth? Why in this city, Caesarea Philippi? Matthew chapter 16, verse 13. Raises this question, who do people say the Son of Man is? Inquire and ask from, Jesus asked this from his disciples, and the inquiry aimed, what actually ordinary people on the fringes of the society who receive our ministry, who are engaged with us, they think about who I am? Some thought he is John the Baptist. I mean, if you compare Matthew's record, what he is saying in chapter 16, with Mark, who was probably the first gospel ever written, Mark did not include Jeremiah. He mentioned John the Baptist and Elijah. And Matthew added Jeremiah, because Jeremiah looks like, if you read the whole gospel of Matthew from a student's point of view, Jeremiah is quoted frequently in the Gospel of Matthew from chapter 1 onward. He quoted Jeremiah as name and also quoted various verses from the book of Jeremiah. I don't know how many of you attended or were engaged with Alpha we had early this year. I think in the second session, the theme is who Jesus is. And if you have gone through that walk pop kind of video, people from different up and down in the country talking about who Jesus is, answers were a person who lived ages ago, a teacher, much like other great teachers, a good guy, I guess. He was a prophet. I really don't know. I should be honest. Different people gave different answers. So which means this question is still relevant, because there may be people in other parts of the world who may not have heard about Jesus, or they may have heard through different sources, may not correct information, so the answer is still same, John the Baptist, one of the prophets, Elijah, a teacher, great inspirer, a revolutionist, and so on and so on. So these initial questions helped Jesus' disciples to receive the messages and feedback about Jesus' ministry and their own ministry. And then Jesus turned this question a little bit more in a directional way, directly asked to his disciples, who do you think I am? What is your belief? What is your understanding about me? We don't know what other disciples of Christ said, but definitely Peter said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Matthew chapter 16, verse 16. When Peter said that, Jesus appreciated. And mostly, Peter was on the other side of receiving Jesus' criticism. But this time, Jesus appreciated. Well done. Good answer. And then Jesus said, you are Peter. Peter means stone, a rock. You are Peter. You are a stone. I will build my church on this. Jesus is not talking about Peter as a person. Jesus is talking about what he simply said. You are the Son of the living God. I'm going to build my church on this belief. Last month, we were in Rome, where we saw the church, which is known as St. Peter's Basilica. Lot of glory given to Peter because he was a true disciple of Jesus Christ. But it is not Peter who matter, but what Peter said. That is significant. You are the Son of the living God, and I will build my church on this statement that the world need to know who I am. I am the Son of the living God, the Messiah, the Savior of the world. When Jesus said that, he is helping us not to too much talk about ourselves. I know I have met people in different contexts, in different denominations, and in different parts of the world. People are more concerned about their identity, maybe their church identity. We are evangelical, we are Baptist, we are Brethren, we are Anglican, we are Catholic-Anglican, we are evangelical, we are charismatic Anglicans, we are Catholic, so on and so on and so on. But Jesus is not concerned who you are, Peter. But what you simply said is so profound. You are the Son of the living God. And on this, not on the name of your church, not on the mission strategy you have, but whatever you believe, whatever you say, that has to be deeply rooted in you are the Son of the living God. Now, coming back to the significance of the location. What I have so far said, I simply said the initial questions Jesus asked from his disciples, and Jesus asked his disciple what people think about me. The place where Jesus asked this question was significantly important. Not only important in its historical context, what happened 2,000 years ago when Jesus asked this question, even today, for mission strategy and for the global world mission. Caesarea Philippi, a pagan city, rebuilt by Herod's son, Philip. And he renamed this city, partially on him and partially on the emperor, Caesar, Augustus. So that's why the city was called Caesarea Philippi. This was famous for pagan gods, especially God with small g, Pan. And when Jesus arrived there with his disciples, many people knew who Jesus was. And Jesus was concerned about his identity. But Jesus was more concerned about his disciples. Because when we are interacted with this sort of context, where there are a lot of religions, a lot of other thoughts, people believe and understand about Jesus and think about life differently. This city, Caesarea Philippi, helps us to reflect and rethink about the world mission. Jesus' disciples were thinking, we are Jews, and our mission context is only within the geographical jurisdiction of Palestine or the Israelites' world, that's all. They had no idea. One day we will be going to Rome, or to India, or to other parts of the world, where context is absolutely different. How we will present Jesus, how we will help people to understand who Jesus is. And in that multicultural and multi-religious context, what kind of our mission strategy will be? The questions posed to Jesus' disciples simply helps us to see our own context, present-day Britain, where we see a lot of diversity. Diversity is great in many ways. The present-day British context is indeed diverse, with a multicultural population and a range of religious beliefs. And it can be described sometime as post-Christian due to the decline of traditional Christian influence and the rise of secularism. In this context, we are called to do mission. In this context, we are called to ask questions from people we live with. In this context, we are called to articulate our faith in a way people can understand well, clearly, and simply who Jesus is. When we refer to the uniqueness of Christ, we are highlighted that the distinct aspects of the Christian belief that Jesus is not only a historical figure who lived 2,000 years ago, like many other great people. Jesus is the Son of the living God. He is living. And how he interacts and relates to us today, there is always a danger when we are encountering with diverse contexts for our faith to be compromised or maybe our faith to be diluted. But that was Jesus' concern. When they were in Jerusalem, they were protected by the context in which they were. When they were with me in Galilee, in Nazareth, all Jews, synagogues, and there was no danger. But now they are in Caesarea Philippi. I don't know for how many days they were there, but Jesus asked this question just to get a feel. Have they been influenced by the context they are? Are they still confident enough to talk about me, talk about them, and are they confident enough to talk about their faith? In the ancient Rome, the Hellenistic world, and even as earlier I was saying in India, the idea of having an other deity or a spiritual figure alongside the existing pantheon was not a challenge, but the challenge was how to tell to the world Jesus is unique, no one is like him, we all need him, and what unique relationship he had with us. Now, I'll flip this question other way around. Jesus asked this question from his disciples. He asked this question. He asked his disciples, what people think about me? What do you think about me? If someone would ask Jesus, who you are, what would be Jesus' answer? I will leave it with you to sort out. Who are you? His response would astound us. He is the Messiah, the Son of God, the Son of the living God, the words Peter used, who came down to this earth to rescue us from our sins. Jesus is our Savior, the one who laid down his life for our redemption and restoration. If you and us, you and I ask Jesus, if the world asks Jesus who you are, he has a lot of simple answers to give. If you are hungry, I am the bread of life. If you have lost hope and don't know where to do and what to do, I am the light of the world. If you are like a lost sheep, I am the door of the sheep. If no one is there to care you, to look after you, I am the good shepherd. If you have lost hope in your life, I am the resurrection, I am the life, and the truth. And if you have no joy in your life, I am the true wine. I am the Son of God, sent to fulfill the divine plan of salvation. I am the embodiment of love, compassion, and truth. I am the way, the truth, and the life, guiding humanity towards a deeper connection with God. I am here for you. I am the one who offers forgiveness and redemption, inviting all to experience eternal life in him and through him. My purpose is to reconcile humanity. My purpose is, my whole plan is to help the world to know, love one another. When people will follow me, the world will become a better place for us all to live. Who Jesus is looks a simple question, but this question can change people's life. Whoever asked this question ever in the history He or she never remained the same, whether this was Paul on the way to Damascus. I would conclude with a simple story of one of my personal heroes, Sadhu Sundar Singh, a great saint from the Indian subcontinent in Punjab, who was a young lad. He had no understanding of Jesus. Once his room was flooded with light, and he asked that light, "Who you are?" And the light said, "I am Jesus to whom you persecute." Then his life was changed. As a young lad, he traveled everywhere in the world, and he left a wonderful legacy that endures, because he had answered to that question, "Who you are?" When we have heard from Jesus, when we have experienced him in our life, we are not only changed, we have the ability to change the world we live in, and the world we live with. God bless you. Amen.
Our next song allows us to enter into this story and to express our views, our experience, our love for Jesus. I suggest we sing this twice, and first time perhaps remain seated and reflect on the words, "All honour, blessing and power belong to you." And then we'll sing it through a second time and we'll stand together to sing. "Jesus shall take the highest honour." May he take the highest honour in each of our lives.
Jesus shall take the highest honor. Jesus shall take the highest honor.
believe and trust in God the Father, who created all that is. I believe and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ, who redeemed humankind. I believe and trust in his Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God. I believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Now Helen's going to come and lead our time of intercessions together.
This morning I shall be referencing some prayers from earlier centuries, reflecting the faith of the earlier followers of Jesus. But many of the themes remain the same today. So the bidding is, in your mercy, and please say, hear our prayer. In your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
A prayer of St. Patrick. Lord, be with us this day, within us to purify us, above us to draw us up, beneath us to sustain us, before us to lead us, behind us to restrain us, and around us to protect us. In your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Dear Lord God, we thank you for all those people down the years who have offered up their prayers and thanksgivings, as well as their petitions, and who have put their trust in you. Help us to follow their example, and we pray especially when the way ahead for us is unclear. A prayer of St. Clement of Rome. We beg you, Lord, to help and defend us. Deliver the oppressed. Pity the insignificant. Raise the fallen. Show yourself to the needy. Heal the sick. Bring back those of your people who have gone astray. Feed the hungry. Lift up the weak. Take off the prisoner's chains. May every nation come to know that you alone are God, that Jesus Christ is your child, that we are your people, the sheep that you pasture. In your mercy. We pray for our church leaders in the wider world, nationally and locally, and we thank you for Rana and the ministry area team. We pray your blessing on all who work here for the common good, for Kerry and the youth team, for all those involved in older people's ministry, for the new Anna chaplain, Nell Corley from Llangattock, and for all who freely give their time and talent. Thank you for the hospitality team and to Catherine, and we thank you for fellowship and fundraising at the Open Church Days during August. Bless all who have come into the church and who have found a special space with us and a warm welcome. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, we know you walk with us during our trials as you share our joys. And now we like to pray for anyone in particular who comes to mind, who has trouble in mind, body or spirit. So we keep a moment of quiet. Lord, in your mercy. Let us bring our prayers to an end with a collect from the 5th century. Bless all who worship thee, from the rising of the sun and to the going down of the same. Of thy goodness give us, with thy love inspire us, by thy spirit guide us, by thy power protect us, and in thy mercy receive us, now and always. Amen. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let's all stand as we come to share God's peace this morning. Jesus met with his disciples in the upper room and he blessed them by sharing peace with them. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Do share a sign of peace one with another this morning. We're going to sing a song now which prepares us for our time of communion together. We hope everyone will be able to stay with us for communion. All those who are Christians are very much welcome to join with us at the table this morning. I didn't say it before, but do stay with us afterwards as well. We have refreshments in the corner there, and there is an opportunity to pray. And you may have been touched by the message this morning about Jesus and an offer that Jesus brings to come to him this morning. If anybody has been touched by that message or has a particular problem or something they'd like to talk through quietly and confidentially, then do come to the Lady Chapel after the service. But we're going to come to a very special place now, that place looking at the cross where Jesus died for us. It's a lovely song, Come and See. We worship at your feet.
Come and see, Lord God, see.
The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to
praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. In Christ, you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us.
He yielded his arms to the Lord on the cross and made for all the sacrifice for sin.
Please be seated. On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Let us pray with confidence to the Father. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. We are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Jesus is the Lamb of God. Happy are those who are called to his supper. You are welcome to the Lord's table if you are accustomed to take communion in your church or fellowship wherever you meet. If for some reasons you would prefer blessings, please do come to the rail and cross your arms.
We have gluten-free wafers, if you like. And if you would like to share the cup with others, Linda will help you. If you would take communion by tincturing, by dipping, please indicate when you come to take communion.
Thank you.
Give thanks to the Lord for He is gracious. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us. What a month, the whole month of August. We had loads of visitors, poured gallons of tea and cut mountains of cakes. You know how much the hospitality and fundraising team raised? Over 1,500. £1,545. On behalf of the team, thank you to all who helped and supported us. There are few things, they are only cakes. There are few things which you can take for your tea and coffee, but you have to give little donations. I love fundraising team. They never miss an opportunity to raise more funds. But anyway, we really thank God. It was not only the opportunity to raise funds. Those who were here in the church during Saturdays and also a Friday, we witnessed how many people passed through these doors, the conversations we had, friendships we made, an opportunity to build kingdom of God in this building, but also in people's lives. Let's give thanks to you, thank to God for all this. You may be aware, there was also a fundraising campaign during August. You remember?
Yes.
What I'm talking about? Ellen. Yes. And you know how much she raised for Yubab to go to Africa?
£1,000.
A little more. Judy? Exact figure. 1,147. Yeah, I mean, fundraising is not an easy thing, but it brings some sort of inspiration and encouragement. And I know how God works in people's life when they come together to support the church community, individuals in their mission and their work. Any other notices?
My nose. We have a birthday girl, I believe, in the church. I can see her hiding behind her hand right now. Don't be embarrassed. It's Jeanette, and we're going to sing Happy Birthday if Vaughan gives us a note. Sorry? And Lynn.
Liz.
And Liz. Yes, Liz. So we've got two birthday girls. Happy birthday to Jeanette and Liz. That's quite a lot. To you, happy birthday, dear Jeanette and Liz. Happy birthday to you.
Yes, not the one more. Can you hear me? Yes, yes. A thank you card from Rachel and Francis. They were married in this church in June. I think most couples, they have wonderful experience of love and affection when they come to listen to their bands, or some have to attend the church for 6 months to qualify their connections. And tea and coffee they enjoyed. And more than that, I have continuously reminded them that there are people in the church who pray for them. It's not only the ticker box and book the church and they'll get nice heating and lighting and horrible vicar, but it's much more than that. The power and the support of prayer that they get from this church. Now, it's the time to sing our final hymn. Let us sing together, when I survey. Okay. Let us bless the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. And the blessings of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you now and always. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Particularly challenging.